Hey, and welcome to the People's Republic of Brighton and Hove, the radio show for your TV. And I am delighted to share the screen with my wonderful friend here, Debs.
Hello.
You know, but from the A team, it's nice to mix the A and B teams together a little bit, don't you think?
Oh, am I from the A team?
Yeah,
oh, that's all right then.
You know, I normally stand here with Jason and, you know, we bring the B to the B team. So we've got a fun-packed show for you tonight. Is it fun-packed? Is it fun-packed?
As always.
We've got yes, it's fun-packed because International Women's Day is coming up.
It is indeed.
Sarah Saeed from Sweet Venues coming in telling us about all their incredibly feminine activities. Who have we got now?
In our first section.
In our first section. This is why you tuned in, by the way.
I am delighted to welcome.
She's delighted.
Paul Young, who is the CEO of Off the Fence. Hello, Paul.
Thank you
so much for joining
us. It's a great pleasure. Thank you.
So tell us, Off the Fence, what is it you do? What's it all about?
Well, Off the Fence is a registered charity in Brighton and Hove. Mm-hmm. We've been going for the last 23 years.
Oh.
We are a charity that works mainly with the homeless. We do a big day centre for the homeless. We have around about 9,000 people last year that was in our day centre. We have the night outreach that reach about 2,000 people over the year. We have an awful lot of other things with that. We have the hygiene vans.
Mm-hmm.
There are three vans that go out to the homeless that give showers to where they're at. Also gives the laundry to a lot of the people that've got no clean clothing. Mm-hmm. And we have the hygiene van that gives everything from toothbrushes to socks right the way to feminine hygiene. Mm-hmm. Covers the whole range. And then we have the schools program, 17,000 students last year. We will go into all the secondary schools and make sure we're preventing homelessness.
Mm-hmm.
And for young people that are struggling through, finding it difficult, we're able to go out and help them.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have the women's centre called Gateway.
Mm.
And we deal with another, 2,000 people there that we work one-to-one. Day centres, go to their homes, help them through everything from depression,
mm-hmm.
Mental health, right the way through to abuse in the family. So Off the Fence does quite a lot of things.
It does.
Just, isn't it? Very rich.
Not just the homeless work. Mm-hmm. But homelessness is the issue. That's where we start.
Yes. Because from what you've just said, Paul, it's not just about working with... You don't just work with people who are currently homeless at this time.
Mm-hmm.
You are working to prevent more people
becoming homeless. Oh, absolutely. It starts in the school.
Mm-hmm.
And we want to be in the schools and with the Gateway project. That's stopping people from becoming homeless. If we can get them in schools, we can... Sorry. We can prevent them from getting onto the streets, where you get images. Some of our programmes show homelessness, like it's almost sexy to be out on the streets, where we're able to go in and say, well, these are the issues, these are the problems. So we have the whole kind of drugs right the way through to, you know, training on about homelessness. But we're also that prevention. There's an awful lot of people that maybe lose a parent or start finishing school. It used to be, before all the cuts, that if there was like self-harming issues or death in the family, you'd get a social worker within three weeks. Now it's 16 months, so we go in.
And a lot can change in that time.
I mean, a lot changes in three weeks, let alone.
Do you think you're doing something that was a statutory activity previously?
Yes, absolutely. We're doing an awful lot that should be a statutory issue right now. I mean... With the whole issue of homelessness, the tragedy of so many people living rough on our streets is a great issue. And where we see 20 or so people die on the streets of Brighton each year, that should be a zero. I mean,
absolutely.
That's an absolute kind of tragedy within our own city. And we try to make a difference.
Mm-hmm. But you were saying to me earlier that the number has been rising. You've been and off the fence has been going for over 20 years, and yes. You have seen that number go up. Are you curious as to the intervention, especially with young people? Mm. It sounds fascinating, and sure, mm-hmm. there's a certain amount of telling the real story mm-hmm. of and de-romanticising being on the street.
Sure.
And like
sure.
that takes that, take that on board. Mm-hmm. And you also talked about this social work stuff, the kind mm-hmm. of waiting 16 months rather than a few
sure.
weeks
yeah.
to have that kind of intervention.
Yes.
What's the most effective? What should be happening in our schools and with our young people?
Well, I think from all right the way through, the austerity cuts have made such an impact. So many of the homeless charities have had cuts,
yeah. mm.
and yet homelessness has doubled in the last 10 years, and it will double again.
Oh,
wow. And, you know, prevention, how do you stop the prevention? Well, we've cut too much into the austerity, into mm-hmm. mental health, mm-hmm. Almost.
So people are not being emotionally supported? What is the cut?
Yes, it's a bit of everything. Mm-hmm. I think that, like, you get house prices that have gone through the roof yeah. in
yes.
Brighton and Hove. There isn't the housing.
Yeah.
When yeah. we started 22 years ago, it's about drugs and drink.
Yeah.
Today
right.
it's about mental health.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So many more. 20% of the people that we look after and we help are ex-military.
Yep.
Well, they 20%. Should not be on the streets.
Yes.
And our mental health, when one of our illustrious prime ministers said, we'll put care into the community.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah. And
sorry.
It was never, ever going to work when you have such complex mm. issues.
Mm.
And so an awful lot of who we work with now should be in hospital. Yeah. They shouldn't be mm. out in the street.
Has there been a change in terms of getting people off the street into more, and I don't want to say conventional
sure.
living, but living that is more healthy,
mm-hmm.
like
yes.
being less homeless? Being homeless may not be unhealthy, though. It often is.
Oh, absolutely it is.
So are we getting less people back into homes?
Sure, there's not the homes there.
Right.
I mean, all the council homes have been sold,
yep.
all the kind of... We've got a major issue within, you know, young people trying to get a house in Brighton.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the issue's not so much can we help those that are poor. The issue is, can we satisfy those that have got rich and got an awful lot of properties?
Yeah.
And that brings up a whole new can of worms, really. An awful lot of people got very rich on the housing
yeah.
issue
yeah.
of Brighton and Hove,
yeah.
and there's an awful lot of people that have just fallen through the
that
nets.
That have been left behind. And
been left behind.
And left, been left homeless.
And when you think of one in every 200 people in Britain are on the edge
yeah. mm.
of becoming homeless. You know, when we talk about Brexit, what are we talking about? We've had a Brexit in Britain
yeah.
for years. The, whether we go through Brexit or not does not impact the homeless.
No.
You know, they're already homeless.
Before we make a
sorry.
Plea to our... No, please don't apologise, yeah. Unless you really want to. Before we make a plea on your behalf to get the people in the Republic to help you more to do the
sure.
good work mm-hmm. you're doing...
Thank you.
What is the argument against... are you enabling people to stay mm-hmm. on the streets? What's the defence against that?
Sure. I mean, you just need to take a night like last night. We see many deaths on the street. We deal with the rougher stages. And yet, over 22 years, we've seen many, many lives change around.
Mm-hmm.
Many people get back and do great things. It's a fallacy people want to remain homeless.
Mm.
If they're drug addicts or got some mental health issues where they can't go in, then that's a far bigger kind
yeah.
of subject. But actually... most of the homeless that we work with, the rough sleeper, they know they're going to die in the winter if we don't get them off. So many of them. And people think, oh, it's a bit brighter now, things are a lot better. But the truth is, the wet and then it gets warm. They're never out of wet clothing. You know, and although we say, oh, 22 people died in Brighton and Hove last year, that was who was found on the street, not those that are in hospital with chest infections, with
illnesses,
gangrene trench foot. You know, none of that is seen.
Those awful things that are part and parcel of sleeping rough.
Parcel, yeah.
We only have a minute left. This is a subject that we could talk to you about all day.
We
will have you back again in the future to update us on all that's going on. In our last minute, what I'd like to ask is, if any members of our Republic see somebody sleeping rough and they want them to tap into the kind of services that Off the Fence provides, what's the best way for them to enable that individual to tap into those services?
Well, we have the street sheet that gives absolutely all the information for the homeless. They can get hold of us on www.offthefence.org.uk. We've got all the emails you'll share about
we'll share
homeless.
Yeah, we'll share all of that.
And so there's an awful lot going on. They can get to us very, very quickly. Everybody knows about Off the Fence, where to get us, and the homeless know.
Brilliant.
Paul, thank you very much.
You're doing absolutely amazing work. Thank you for
joining us today.
And thank you for joining us, and we'll see you after the break. Thank you very much. Thank you so much for joining us in the second half of the show. In the first half, we spoke to Paul Young, CEO of Off the Fence. Paul, just wanted to let our viewers know that if you are interested in doing some volunteer work with Off the Fence, please have a look at the Off the Fence website. And also, they've got a very exciting event coming up, the CEO Sleep Out on the 6th of April. So please refer to the website for more details about that. Hello, Jason. Hello. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Pleasure.
Should we crack
on? To be in the A team with the A team.
Well.
Who are the C team then?
We haven't got to a C team yet. We can't recruit enough people to get a C team together.
That's fair enough. Okay.
Can I ask you please to very kindly tell us who we shall be speaking to next?
No, I shan't.
Right.
No.
Okay.
Well, you know, being a woman yourself.
Sometimes it's hard to be.
I've heard that sung somewhere. International Women's Day is rushing towards us.
It is coming up, yes.
A tray full of tea and cake. And anyway, so I'm going to die now. I'm going to put 10 minutes of agony.
You are outnumbered.
I'm outnumbered 2
I'll
to 1.
I'll tell you why you're outnumbered.
And she's not small. She's a strong woman. It's Sarah Saeed, who's going to punch me in the face.
If I don't do it first. Sarah, we're gonna just kind of block him out. Sarah, you are here to tell us about some very exciting events for International Women's Day.
Can I just start by saying Jason's barred from Novelastic on International Women's Day.
You're first. Barred.
I'm barred.
You're barred.
I'm barred from the interview as well.
And we will have tea.
Damn.
So,
which you'll be making as your pens. So, anyway, so you are here.
Hello.
You are here to tell us International Women's Day. It's on the 8th of March. I know it's on the 8th of March because that's my best mate's birthday as well, which seems very apt. Hi, Vicky. But International Women's Day, it's coming up. You being a great organiser and knower of events, come to tell us about some really exciting events in this fair city.
Yeah.
All about International Women's Day. Go.
Okay, so it is International Women's Day this Friday, which is the 8th of March.
Right.
I personally am of lava elastic, not sweet venues, but I'm here talking with like two hats on today.
Wow.
I know, you can't even see them.
I can't even see one hat, that's incredible.
but I'm here to talk about sweet venues, International Women's events.
So Sweet Venues is in Middle Street, isn't it?
It is. Right. Yes. It's at the Works Group in Middle Street.
Yes.
And they've got some events that are running from Wednesday this week until Saturday.
Right.
But on Friday evening, I have a Lava Elastic for Women's Day. And that's on Friday the 8th.
Because Lava Elastic is, correct me if I'm wrong, it is the country's first neurodiverse comedy and performance night.
Yeah, yeah.
Set up and run by your good self.
So what does neurodiverse mean?
So neurodiverse basically means that the performers that are on the bill are really varied in that neurodiversity means that we have different kinds of brains mm-hmm. as human beings. So the performers might be on the autistic spectrum, mm-hmm. and there's quite a few of us that, mm-hmm. that mm-hmm. are under that category. Mm-hmm. Or we might have ADHD mm-hmm. or bipolar disorder mm-hmm. or just, you know, different, basically, that are considered wired differently.
Right, mm-hmm. okay.
But that does mean that sometimes the usual comedy and performance circuit perhaps isn't the most welcoming or mm-hmm. easy to navigate place, mm-hmm. if that makes sense.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah, I can imagine.
So, Lava Elastic, the whole point is to, you know, just sort of put us all in a space and say, talk about what you want to. And it's a safe space.
So it's essentially taking into consideration the fact that we are all wired differently.
Yes, totally.
That is basically,
yeah, basically.
What it is.
But also, the whole point is actually just to also take away the distinction, because mm-hmm. I'm not set... It's not like neurotypical performers, which is the opposite of neurodivergent, mm-hmm. Right. which is considered the normal brain.
yeah, exactly. Seen some comedians.
It's normal.
Exactly.
You know,
well, that's
we know that. There's no such thing. Mm-hmm. But, you know, that means that we all just muck in together and get mm-hmm. on stage and talk about our stuff. Mm-hmm. And everyone's cool with it.
Yeah. Well, I think one of your evenings, there was one comedian who's lousy. I can't remember her name. Deb somebody. But the rest of it was really
You were just cruising for a reason, aren't you?
It was a really good evening because it was such a diversity of entertainment.
Yes.
Styles.
It's a real mixed bag, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Because the whole point about it is, I mean, I feel a bit bad saying it, but quite often over the years I've been to comedy nights and I've just been really, really bored.
Yeah.
And the fact that there's quite a narrow parameter acts can... I'm not saying there's not some amazing nights out there, but the point is that sometimes I find that they're a little bit limited by not having very unusual acts on the bill.
But I think the thing is, Sarah, is being an act myself, one thing that being sort of in the sort of on the circuit for a few years now, is it used to always be about gender. We're not seeing enough women coming through, we're not seeing enough of that, and now you've kind of come along and said, well, OK, but it's not just about gender, it's about...
Yeah, it's really not.
It's about people who are on the autistic spectrum or who are not, you know, who are neurodivergent. Did I say that right?
Yeah, totally. Neurodivergent in basically any way.
Yeah. So you've kind of brought that into kind of essentially just... and the existence of that must make somebody who classifies as that, who is a performer, go, oh, hang on a minute, I am accepted. I can kind of come in and I can do my thing and I don't have to feel kind of marginalised for that reason. Yeah. And so that's really important. And the event on Friday is for International Women's Day. It's an all-female event?
It is, actually.
Can I hold up the poster?
Yeah, absolutely. Go for it. You can
very,
show it.
Very
or,
much.
You
know, I take this show.
we're working very much with our visual aids today so that we remember things. That's my ADHD brain needing visual cues to remember things. There's some fantastic people on this Friday.
I'm not going to tell you who they are.
We are. Wow. I'm going to tell you about them.
Yeah, of course you are.
Very excitingly, you've probably just flashed it, haven't you? So I can talk about them now.
Please.
Joe Neary is one of my... I've got I'm going to reveal myself as a nerdy fangirl here. And actually, she's going to be really nervous to come and see my night. I could do my night after this. But I've seen her over the years in Brighton.
Yes.
And also, she does Radio 4.
Yep.
She's appeared in programmes like Ideal. Mm. But on the comedy circuit, she has these amazing character comedy nights.
Yep.
Yeah, I've seen her a few times.
There's nobody that doesn't have lovely things.
She was part of Barbecue the Musical, which was one of the highlights
at
the Brighton Bridge for me last year.
She was brilliant in it.
She was amazing.
I mean, everybody was wonderful
in
it.
It was a five-star show.
But she was really brilliant in it. And I've got her for this Friday.
Wonderful.
And I never dreamed that I'd get her to be my little night. There's Cheeky Keita,
amazing.
Who is hard to describe, but some people have described her as Alice in Wonderland on Adderall.
Yes.
Or like a one-woman Mighty Boosh.
You name it.
She's she's
incredible,
pretty extraordinary. Mm-hmm. She's very, very different. She's got her own style. Victoria Melody, who
adorable.
She has her own shows on the theatre circuit.
Yes.
But has now started turning her hands to comedy in the last few years, mm-hmm. and she's really brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
Rachel Quinn, Lou Carr. Relatively new on the
circuit. Yeah, newbies, but great.
Yeah, mm-hmm. just brilliant. And also Rebecca Turner, who, if anybody's seen Rebecca Turner, they just know that she's just something else. You just have to see her. She's wonderful.
She is wonderful.
She's unusual. She's very much herself. She's a brilliant comedy writer.
And a lovely person. And a friend of mine. Somebody who I consider to be a friend.
Yeah, she's a proper sweetheart.
She really is. She is. So that is a great lineup for Lava Lassie. We've probably got a couple of minutes left. Can you take us through, in the last bit, the other venues that Sweetworks are
going
to be...
The other events that they've got on.
Having on for International Women's Day.
I'm just going to have to faff around for a moment.
No, that's fine. Okay.
Because I'm speaking on behalf of Sweet Venues here.
Thank you for doing so.
Because they've got these amazing events on.
Please, share.
But I don't know quite as much about the thorough dealings of...
That's fine.
...theirs as I do Lava Elastic, which I could talk about for 3 days.
Yeah,
3 days. Yeah, 2 minutes. On the 6th of March, there's the absolutely brilliant Cast Iron Theatre.
We've had them on. We love them. We love
brilliant.
Them. Anyone pulse us, you know, we can.
they're local and they're fantastic. Yep. And they've got a show on called Not Just the Companion. Mm-hmm. So that is on the 6th of March.
Fantastic.
And it's an evening show. Mm-hmm. It's not really for kids. It's like 12 plus.
Okay, that's great.
Agent Provocateur, which is a brilliant, brilliant lady called Jojo Bellini.
Mm-hmm. I've heard of her, yeah.
Yeah, and she's on the 7th of March, mm-hmm. And that's called Agent Provocateur, and it's a cabaret about a female spies.
Brilliant. We love a bit of cabaret.
And actually, there's a really interesting event. There's a lady called Tracy Wise, who is a mm-hmm. female magician.
Oh, wow. You don't see many female magicians.
Yes, exactly. You really, really don't, do you?
No.
I don't think I've ever seen one.
I can't think of one.
Which is kind of amazing. She's got a show on the 9th of March called Once Upon a Crime.
Oh, that sounds great.
It just sounds great. It's a retelling of Little Red Riding Hood, but using magic to kind of help with the storytelling.
Is that suitable for kids?
Oh, that is very much suitable for kids. Yeah. And that's on the 9th of March. And the brilliant thing is that on the 9th of March also there is a workshop called Believe, Finding Your Magic. And it's for little girls to learn how to do magic.
It's needed, obviously.
Absolutely brilliant. Sarah, we're coming to the end.
That's fine.
Thank you so much. Good luck with Lava Lassie. Thank you for telling us about all of those fabulous events. And thank you, our viewers, for tuning in. Do join us next time. Good night.